So I'm going to talk about the periphery, completely far away from what we have been listening today. So what I will try to do today is convince you that this, I would say, quotes old technique, but with new updates and new ways of looking into it that you will see in a moment. It's a very nice and neat way of studying what's going on in the periphery of some patients that have neuropathic pain. You know neuropathic pain. Neuropathic pain is this condition that appears, that appears in patients that have diseases or damages to the peripheral nervous system. You know that there are many etiologies that can end in this syndrome that we call neuropathic pain, polyneuropathies. You may have focal nerve injury, viral infections, and the sequela of these viral infections, like postherpetic neuralgia, patients with radiculopathy. You will see that there are many etiologies that end with a syndrome that we call neuropathic pain. As you can imagine, this is almost a mystery, why so many etiologies end having the same syndromic presentation. And that's, I think, one of the key factors that has kind of slowed down the development of new drugs in this field. This is some basic stuff. You know that whenever there is a disease of the nervous system, there may be two types of phenomena that appear. What we call negative phenomena and positive phenomena. This is very Jacksonian, many, many years ago. So in terms of, if you divide the thing between different systems, motor, sensory, autonomic, and negative and positive, you will see that you can fill the boxes with different symptoms and signs that appear in these patients. Pain is a positive sensory phenomena that appears in cases of peripheral neuropathic pain. These patients are complex in the presentation. For instance, this is a patient with a traumatic nerve injury. Of course, the patient comes to you without any of these tattoos. These tattoos are very nice once they are done. But when the patient comes to you, the patient, the only thing that says is, I have pain and I have abnormal sensations here. It's your job to try to disentangle which these abnormal sensations are. So you can do these tattoos, but take into account or take notice that all these tattoos refer to things that are evoked. So I can do something on the patient and I will find that the patient has a sensory loss. And then I will mark this area of touch hyperesthesia. Or I can tap the nerve and the patient will have a tingling which is projected to the innervation territory of this nerve and I will say this is a TNL sign. But the only symptom that really bothers the patient or bothers most the patient and the symptom that most of the pharma companies are after is one that I cannot put in this slide and it's a spontaneous pain. So spontaneous pain is what the patient complains when the patient comes to you in an outpatient clinic, for instance, saying, I have pain in my feet because I have a diabetes, or I have pain in my arm because I had a focal nerve injury. Unfortunately, this is a subjective symptom, so there is no way of taking an objective measure of the amount of pain of this patient the patient is experiencing. So in a way, the only means, the only biomarker that we have at that moment is verbal communication, communicating with the patient and asking how much pain the patient has. In terms of the pathophysiology of these different phenomena, I think this is a very simple slide, but it's very illustrating. So when we have negative sensory phenomena, if I put it in a very simple way, the cause, the pathophysiology of a negative phenomena is that there are action potentials that are not arriving. Okay, let me put it in a very straightforward and simple way. And we know that it's action potentials because up to now, what we know about the function or the transmission of information in the nervous system is that this information transmission is done through action potentials. Okay, we may be wrong. There are people out there saying that action potentials are not important, but as far as we know now, information is through action potentials. So if there is a loss, it's because there are no action potentials. This lack of action potentials arriving somewhere could be due that the anatomical substrate is gone. So you have diabetes, for instance, so you have a degeneration of the peripheral neuron in your nerve, and then there is no substrate, no action potential. It could be that I have been sleeping like this, and I have a conduction block, so I generate my action potentials normally, but they are blocked at a focal lesion of demyelination. Or it could be that you have some central inhibitory, top-bottom influence that is preventing your information to reach your consciousness, so you are not experiencing that sensation. But the contrary is also very important, and here is where microneurography has a role here, is that positive sensory phenomena, for instance, pain or paresthesias, it necessarily means that there are action potentials that have been generated somewhere and that will be arriving somewhere else. Okay? I will try to answer the first question. I am not going to deal with the second question. fMRI people or people doing central stuff are probably much better than me to argue where they are arriving and how these signals are decoded into a conscious perception. But in terms of where and how they are generated, these are the two questions that we really need to answer. Is first of all, if a patient with a peripheral neuropathic pain, patient with a diabetes, for instance, has pain, is because there are action potentials. So where are these action potentials being generated? That's a very fundamental question. And believe it or not, up to 5 or 6 years ago, there was no clear clue of where these action potentials were generated. Many people were saying, oh, this is in the peripheral neurons that are hyperexcitable and they generate action potentials. But there was a large body of people saying, no, 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 the periphery is not important. What's going on is something in the CNS. You have central sensitization, for instance, at the level of the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. And here is where all the action potentials are generated. So there was quite a lot of controversy about where they are generated. Once you know where they are generated, then you can try to answer the second question, which I think is the most relevant one in terms of drug development, is how these abnormal action potentials are generated. Because if we understand how they are generated, then we will probably be in a better position to try to develop new drugs. Believe it or not, we still don't know how these action potentials are generated in diseased peripheral sensory neurons. How do we study these action potentials? Well, this is another slide that I kind of like. If you put on the left all the techniques, electrophysiological techniques and other sorts of techniques that we have nowadays, both in the clinic and some of them also at the animal level, and then you divide the thing between negative phenomena and positive phenomena, coming from myelinated fiber on unmyelinated fibers, you will see that we are very well equipped in trying to study both positive and negative phenomena studying negative phenomena both for myelinated and unmyelinated fibers, but in terms of positive phenomena coming from unmyelinated fibers, which is basically the pain fibers that we are interested in, you will see that there are only two types of techniques. On one side we have a QST, which is quantitative sensory testing, which is basically quantifying and standardizing a medical interview. Okay, you ask the patient how much pain you have with my maneuvers, how much sensation can I evoke with my maneuvers, and you quantify the thing. So it's still a psychophysical test. The only other one that you have and remains is microneurography, because microneurography can really record the action potentials that are behind these spontaneous spontaneous pains and sensations that the patients have. So this is what I will try to do, try to explain a little bit the basics of these techniques and some of the recordings and some of the things that you can detect by using microneurography. In terms of what the technique is, it's a very simple in conception. So what you do is you record action potentials from within a nerve. So you impale a nerve in the periphery, like the superficial peroneal nerve here, with microelectrodes, and then you stimulate electrically receptive field of this impaled nerve, and then you evoke action potentials that will be conducted and recorded at the recording site. Of course, you have a conduction distance, and then you get recordings that look like this, in which by knowing the conduction distance, you can easily calculate the conduction velocity. So basically, this is what it looks like. You have an early component of several action potentials that correspond to the thinly myelinated fibers, and then a very late component of action potentials that correspond to the C fibers. If you keep stimulating the receptive field, what happens, obviously, is that you get, for instance, in this example, you have two action potentials, one here and one here, 110 and 140 something. These action potentials, which are time locked to the stimulus, occur at very stable latencies. Okay, so if you keep repeating, you will have something like this that repeats all the time. But if you change the stimulation rate, for instance, like I'm doing here, so you are stimulating at very low rates of stimulation, like 0.25 hertz, then you can change the stimulation rate here. You can go faster. If you go faster, these C fibers, these unmyelinated fibers in the periphery, have a present or display a behavior which is very characteristic that we call activity-dependent slowing of conduction velocity. Okay, this activity depending of slowing of conduction velocity, of course, is reflected as an increase in the latency, and they produce what we call a profile of activity depending slowing. Okay, this activity depending slowing of conduction velocity depends on the specific repertoire of ion channels and pumps that these neurons have in the periphery. So it's a thing which is very stereotyped. So if I repeat the same high frequency stimulation, then I will have exactly the same profile of activity depending slowing. This thing that could be a kind of a curiosity, it's turned out to be very good and very convenient, because what we can do is that we have discovered some years ago that the different subpopulation of fibers or axons that populate a peripheral nerve display different profiles of activity depending slowing. So we have profiles like shark fins here, which correspond to the nociceptors, and other types of profiles. So at the end of the day, what you have here is quartz, a very relatively simple technique by which I put a needle in the nerve, I do little tricks with my stimulation rates in the periphery, and I can know immediately whether I am recording from a nociceptor or from other types of fibers in the periphery. It's not only that we can distinguish the nociceptors from the rest, it's that we can distinguish the two main classes of peripheral nociceptors that mammals have. What we call the mechanosensitive, which is the IV4 positive, the purinergic nociceptor, is what it was some time ago called CMH nociceptor, from the mechanoinsensitive, which is IV4 negative, or the peptidergic, is the NGF-dependent nociceptor. This class of nociceptor is turning out as a very interesting class, because it looks like when you have pathology like diabetes, polyneuropathy due to diabetes, or other types of small fiber neuropathy, this is the type of nociceptor that displays most of the spontaneous activity that we believe is the cause of the spontaneous pain of these patients. So this is a recording from humans. This is how it looks. You have, it's always a multi-unit recording in which you have different types of profiles. Your softwares, the softwares we have, can extract the different fibers that we're interested. And in this example, for instance, there are three nociceptors, three shark fins, and two flat units that do not correspond to nociceptors. So what do you see when you record from patients? You see several things. I have tried to summarize some of them. I don't know. I will try to show you the first three if I have time, maybe the fourth one as well. But basically what you see is spontaneous ongoing discharges, instances of peripheral sensitization, a thing that we have named multiple spikes or double spiking or triple spiking, and then different changes in axonal membrane properties that really gives you clues of what's going on in these fibers. So this is another thing I want to introduce here, is that when you have a C fiber which is resting, you get latency profiles that are flat. So what's going on here? So imagine the situation. I am giving an electrical shock to the receptive field, so I am generating, inducing an action potential. This action potential is recorded here. I have put a dot, it's the same, a dot on the peak of the action potential, so it makes it's easier to visualize, but it's exactly the same. So I give an electrical pulse, I have my action potential here, and I give a second electrical pulse, and I have my action potential here, and so on. So there is a little bit of jitter, of course. If you magnify the latency scale here, you will see that there is a little bit of jitter because of noise in the conduction, but the jitter is very small. If the fiber is spontaneously active, what you get is a latency profile which is very jittery. It has this kind of sawtooth. And this is why, because this is, I am stimulating here, I have my action potential, and then some seconds later I'm stimulating again and I have my action potential here again. If between my artificially evoke action potential and my next one, the fiber is engaged in spontaneous activity, depending on how many action potentials this fiber has generated, I will have more or less activity depending slowing of conduction velocity. Okay, so this changes this sawtooth depend on the amount of spontaneous activity that the fiber is having or displaying by itself. So remember that this is a recording from humans. We know that some fibers, some C fibers, have a spontaneous activity. For instance, this is a normal recording. This is a cold thermoreceptor. So this is a fiber that is discharging because the room temperature is in humans. Room temperature is a little bit low. So this fiber is engaged in spontaneous activity. This recording here and this recording here is the same fiber. The only difference that I have warm up the receptive field, and then I go from spontaneous activity to no activity, to a flat type of recording. Peripheral nociceptors in mammals are normally quiet. Okay, so our nociceptive, peripheral nociceptive system is not engaged in spontaneous activity under normal conditions. And this makes a lot of sense because we have a system which is sitting there waiting for a kind of adequate noxious stimulus to impinge in our skin or somewhere to discharge and signal that there is something wrong going on. So because the nociceptors are quiet, what we get is this kind of flat lines. You see that all these shark fins that I'm displaying here have this kind of flat baselines. If you do the same type of recordings in patients with peripheral neuropathy that have spontaneous pain, which is most of the cases spontaneous burning pain, you get something which is completely different, something that looks like this. And what you can see here is that several of these shark fins display these very regular sawtooth-like baselines. Like here, for instance, you have one sawtooth, another one, and another one. This is a kind of ongoing thing. Please look into the time base here. So this is 50 minutes, 1 hour, 1 hour, 10 minutes. So it's not a spontaneous activity which is short-lived. It's something which is ongoing, and it's there all the time. And if you record in the morning, it's there. If you record in the afternoon, it's there. If you have a patient with peripheral neuropathy that precise day has zero pain in the foot, the amount of spontaneous activity is very much reduced or absent totally. So there's a very direct translation between the amount of spontaneous activity you have and the amount of pain that you are experiencing. So this is an example of spontaneous activity. What you see here, if it works, let me see. Maybe I have to click here. So you have, again, an example. So many minutes, this is 10 minutes. It's been accelerated, of course. You have a unit that is jittering right and left, so longer and shorter latencies, depending on how much spontaneous activity the fiber is sustaining. So this is a kind of typical recording that you see in patients and in rats that have spontaneous activity due to a peripheral neuropathy. The image or the profiles of normal nociceptors versus spontaneous reactive nociceptors are pathognomonic. There is no confusion. So just by visual inspection, you can say that these bottom nociceptors are engaged in spontaneous activity. So it's a very nice way of detecting this abnormal behavior in nociceptors. The interesting thing is that if you look at rats, this is rats and humans, and then not only rats or human, but different etiologies. That's focal nerve injury models in rat, like a crush in the sciatic nerve, or a cut and suture of the sciatic nerve, or a chronic constriction injury, or more polyneuropathy models, like a kind of STZ model of induced diabetes, or a DDC, it's not displaying, sorry, a DDC model, oh, here it is, DDC model of antiretroviral neuropathy. You see that the profiles of spontaneous activity are pretty similar and very similar to what happens in small fiber neuropathy, painful small fiber neuropathy in humans. So it looks like this spontaneous activity is very stereotyped, and this is very good news to us because that means that, yes, we have many etiologies that can induce neuropathic pain, but it looks like that there is somewhere in the system a bottleneck in which the end result is a spontaneous activity. Okay, if we were able to identify which is this bottleneck that produces this spontaneous activity, that would be a perfect target for peripheral neuropathic pain. Of course, we can try to quantify that, and we have developed different ways of doing that over the years, and we have very nice softwares that do these things. This departure from the baseline, so this is a nociceptor with its spontaneous activity, this departure from the baseline, the magnitude of this departure is directly proportional to the amount of spontaneous activity. So what you can do is back translate the thing, and then you can get automatize quantification methods of the amount of spontaneous activity. And this automatized method can be used for pharmacological interventions, for instance, in which, for instance, there is a measure that we call TI, it doesn't matter what it means, total increase, and then you have a pharmacological intervention at minute zero, and you can see that there is a clear modulation of this spontaneous activity. In terms of peripheral sensitization, this is another abnormality. That's a patient, for instance, that had extreme cold allodynia, and this is a cold stimulus here, and after this cold stimulus, you have a kind of ongoing spontaneous activity. This fiber is sensitized to cold, and this is an example here of this fiber doing this thing. This is a bone fry, this is a hot rod, and then this cold air that's been applied here, and then after 30 minutes, this is 40, 10 minutes of relentless spontaneous activity, ongoing spontaneous activity. So this patient has a peripheral nociceptor which is sensitized to cold. This spontaneous activity and this peripheral sensitization, it's also been detected in fibromyalgia. That's a kind of big surprise. Everybody was saying that fibromyalgia is a central phenomenon, it's a central disease of hyperexcitable CNSs. Where we are trying to challenge this, what we have seen is that many of these patients with fibromyalgia, they have spontaneous activity and peripheral sensitization, which is mostly to mechanical stimuli. Another one, multiple spikes. I don't think I have time for that. It's a neat phenomenon that can explain hyperalgesia, which is resolved at the peripheral level only. In terms of changes in axonal membrane properties, there are things like, for instance, very simple things. You can compare the conduction velocity of these C fibers between spontaneous and resting fibers. And we immediately saw some years ago that the spontaneously active fibers have, on average, a lower conduction velocity. We are interpreting these results as due to the fact that these fibers are thinner in diameter. And that's a very important point because we know that the diameter, the axon size, has a direct relationship of how stable this fiber is going to be and whether how easy this fiber is going to discharge. In fibromyalgia, we have seen that some of these fibers have extreme cases of activity-dependent slowing at very low rates, and the only explanation for that is that these patients have thinner peripheral nerve. There is a paper just published a couple of weeks ago in Pain by another group, a German group, doing electron microscopy in the skin in fibromyalgia, showing a clear-cut reduction in the diameters of skin terminals in fibromyalgia patients. So to summarize, this is microneurography. You have a subject, you can put the needle, you can record from both type of axons in the periphery, you have profiles that correspond to the different subpopulations of fibers. We know that the nociceptors are quiet, so flat baselines, whereas the nociceptors in pathology, they have these jittery baselines, these sawtooths. The nice thing and the translational thing of microneurography is that we have adapted the technique to the rat, so we can do on both species. So we have patients and animals. In the animal model, we can try to reproduce the pathology in human. We can do pathology of the nerve, of the peripheral nerve, to make sure that both conditions are the same. We can apply the same techniques. We are basically using the same equipment for the animal, for the rat, and the readouts that we get are exactly the same. So we believe this is a very translational approach in the study of peripheral neuropathic pain that can be applied in drug development programs. And actually, this is what any pharma company or biotech company would like to see, is a situation like this in which you have a peripheral nociceptor, which has spontaneous activity, then you apply your test compound, and then what happens is this spontaneous activity disappears. Whoever gets this will get a gold mine here, because this is going to be very effective in treating neuropathic pain. Problem is that nobody has this yet, and I think we are still a little bit far away. This can be applied in clinical trials. We participated in these clinical trials a couple of years ago, 1.5 years ago, on a T-type calcium channel blocker, in which the primary outcome of the study was modulation of spontaneous activity using microneurography. And I think that this technique is going to show great potential in the next probably coming months in terms of new clinical studies. So let me wrap up by saying that we have a technique that can record from C fibers, for unmyelinated fibers in humans and animals, that this spontaneous activity and peripheral sensitization is very typical, very stereotypical of these conditions. We have a method that can recognize this spontaneous activity, not only recognize, but quantify it. And because it can quantify, it can be applied in pharmacological interventions. So we can try to produce answers like, does my compound stop spontaneous activity in peripheral nociceptor, yes or no? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Time for one or two quick questions. Andy.
So, I mean, I know you're recording multi-unit activity here, but let me ask you the question. I mean, if you were able to record from single identified fibers, do you think to get the jitter wobbling latency, that fiber has to be itself active, or does it just have to be within an active nerve?
No, it's the fiber itself that needs to be active.
Definitely. Okay,
yes, you mean by activity in neighboring fibers? That's
yes,
what.
Yeah. So spontaneous activity in neighboring fibers is not sufficient to make.
No, it doesn't. It's the insulation, the crosstalk, so to speak, between fibers. It doesn't affect the spontaneous activity. Sometimes what you get is what we call a kind of conduction entrainment, in which you have two fibers that are doing like this. So one is slowing much more than the other, but when they get together, they entrain for a while, and then they separate again. Probably this is a kind of electrical crosstalk between the two fibers for a short segment. But activity in neighboring fibers does not induce activity in a single fiber.
Are the spontaneous spikes initiating at the same place that the evoked spikes are? So, you know, are the ones that are driven by a nociceptive stimulus?
No. I don't think so. So we believe that this spontaneous activity bypass the transductor mechanism. So it's not related to trip channels and things like this. We think that this is related to sproutings, very thin sproutings, and this is the place where the electrogenesis is taking place.
You still think they're orthograde rather than retrograde?
They are orthograde. We have good evidence by we have been doing lots of proximal blocks. Because at some time there were even people thinking, oh, these are dorsal root reflexes that are transmitted. No, no, no. It's coming from the periphery. We have good evidence it is from the sprouts.
Brilliant talk. Thank you very much. I wanted to ask, have you considered looking at this efferent activity alongside of this? Because it's obviously associated with pain as well. Has that been done as part of these previous studies? Or?
We can certainly record from sympathetic, so we can even, we have also produced some papers on the sympathetic, how they look, and the only thing we've done over the years is try to, you remember this old story of sympathetically maintained pain, okay, that there was this theory that the sympathetic efferents were somehow influencing the nociceptor afferent. We have not been able to produce any solid evidence that this is the case.